Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this video worship service made for the members and friends of the First United Church of East Syracuse. We hope that soon we will be able to live stream our worship services from the church sanctuary and that in the fall we will resume worship in our building. In the meantime, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
Today's call to worship comes from Psalm 63. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you, so I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name, for you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. Scripture declares, if we walk in the light as Christ is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore offer ourselves in prayer before God's throne of grace. Let us pray. The path that you choose for us, O God, is to loose the bonds of injustice, to let the oppressed go free, to share our bread with the hungry, and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Lord, we confess that too often we fail to proclaim your name, and we do not bring good news to those who need to hear of your salvation. Forgive us for the weakness of our faith, and our failure to let your glory shine through all we do. Give us courage to go where we are sent, to speak what we believe, and to live by the example of love that your Son Jesus has set before us, so that we may be salt for the earth and a shining light for all who dwell on it. Amen. Blessed are those who put their trust in the Lord and who delight to do God's will. We trust in the Lord our God, who has redeemed us by the power of great mercy and grace. Hear the good news. In Christ we are forgiven. Amen. Reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. But because of the Lord's great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages Christ might show the incomparable riches of God's grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by the Holy Spirit. For the word of God within us, thanks be to God. For the word of God among us, thanks be to God. For the word of God in Scripture, thanks be to God. Thank you.
There is something that I see in the way you look at me. There's a smile that's a truth in your eyes. What an unexpected way on this unexpected day. Could it be this is where to show the other side, alone in the night without you. But now I know just who you are, and I know you hold my heart. Finally, this is where I belong, and it is you. There's no more mystery. It is finally clear to me. You're the hum my heart searched for so long. It is you I have loved. It is you I have loved. It is you I have loved. Oh.
A reading from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 10. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. May God bless the reading of this holy word. Amen.
I was there to hear your voice.
Please take a moment of silent prayer. Let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me in a unison affirmation of faith. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed, and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain, and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith, sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the Church. From the Presbyterian Church, USA, brief statement of faith.
Stepping on the clouds, he will greet us all. Joy together, we will chair. I'm gonna leave this world behind me, going where the devil cannot find me. I'm going higher. Jesus rise to meet him in the air. Stepping on the clouds, he will greet us all to joy. Together we will share. I'm gonna leave this world behind me, going where the devil cannot find me. I'm going higher, higher. Stepping on the clouds. Yes, we'll be stepping on the clouds. We'll see Jesus rise to meet him in the air. Stepping on the clouds, he will greet us all. The joy together we will share. I'm gonna leave this world behind me, going where the devil cannot find me. I'm going higher, higher, higher. Stepping on the clouds, I'm going higher, higher, higher. Stepping on.
The word of God as spoken to the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 37, verses 1 through 14. Ezekiel says, I felt the Lord's power take control of me, and God's spirit carried me to a valley full of bones. The Lord showed me all around, and everywhere I looked, I saw bones that were dried out. He said, Ezekiel, son of man, can these bones come back to life? I replied, Lord God, only you can answer that. He then told me to say, Dry bones, listen to what the Lord is saying to you. I, the Lord God, will put breath in you, and once again you will live. I will wrap you with muscles and skin and breathe life into you. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I did what the Lord said, but before I finished speaking, I heard a rattling noise. The bones were coming together. I saw muscles and skin cover the bones, but they had no life in them. The Lord said, Ezekiel, now say to the wind, the Lord God commands you to blow from every direction and to breathe life into these dead bodies so they can live again. As soon as I said this, the wind blew among the bodies, and they came back to life. They all stood up, and there were enough to make a large army. The Lord said, Ezekiel, the people of Israel are like dead bones. They complain that they are dried up and that they have no hope for the future. So tell them, I, the Lord God, promise to open your graves and set you free. I will bring you back to Israel. And when that happens, you will realize that I am the Lord. My spirit will give you breath, and you will live again. I will bring you home, and you will know that I have kept my promise. I, the Lord, have spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Many of us learned the story of Ezekiel's vision of dry bones through Sunday school and the old spiritual Dem Bones, where we learned that the toe bone was connected to the foot bone was connected to the heel bone was connected to the ankle bone, and so on. Ezekiel was a priest of Judah, living in Jerusalem in the 6th century BC. For years he prophesied against Judah's idolatry, warning the people of God's coming judgment against them. When Jerusalem fell, he was part of the first exile, deported to Babylon. While in exile, his preaching shifted from a prophecy of judgment to a message of hope. He reminded the people of God's love for them and spoke to their desire to return to their homeland and to their longing to worship again in the temple of Jerusalem. Before the exile, the sin Ezekiel prophesied against was idolatry. Now, when we hear the word idolatry, we usually think of idols made from wood or stone, objects that were worshipped in place of God. But in fact, an idol does not have to be an object that people bow down to pray or to worship. It can be anything that takes the place of putting God first in your life. In Ezekiel's time, the hearts of the people were turned away from their worship of God. After the exile, the people realized how far they had strayed. They realized that the things they thought were important before were not nearly as meaningful. Like the song says, "You don't know what you got till it's gone." People don't always appreciate what we have until we don't have it anymore. I think that is something we are experiencing right now in the church. We're realizing just how much we've taken the church for granted, thinking it would always be there, whether or not we attended worship every week, whether or not we were actively involved in its work, whether or not we participated in everything the church did, or if we came only once in a while. We miss having the comfort that the church has always provided, of knowing that it would be open and ready when we needed it, for our weddings and funerals, our baptisms and celebrations, for families to come for special services on Christmas Eve and Easter, or for the fellowship of gatherings for church dinners and events, and of course, for worship. Like Ezekiel and his people in exile, unable to worship in the temple, we haven't been able to worship in our church buildings for a little while now. It's as if we've been exiled, not by the Babylonians, but by a virus. We haven't been deported to a foreign land, but our new way of life in the land that we live and love seems foreign to us, and we long to go home, back to the way it used to be. When the people of Judah long to go home, they complain to God. The Lord said, "Ezekiel, the people of Israel are like dead bones. They complain that they are dried up and that they have no hope for the future." Some people are saying the same thing about our churches today. We're dried up. We have no hope. We haven't been taken away from our literal homeland as the people of Judah were taken away, but the land we live in has changed. Our church buildings have not been destroyed by an enemy army, but they sit empty as we work out ways to gather safely and protect the most vulnerable among us. Church leaders, myself included, have offered hope by reminding us that the church is not the building, but the people. Earlier, we read Paul's words to this effect. "Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone." In Christ, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple to the Lord. And in Christ, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by the Holy Spirit. We are a dwelling. The psalmist also reminds us that we do not need to go to a building to find the Lord, for God is everywhere. "Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence?" And yet, for all we know and believe that the church is the people and not the building, we long to return to a sense of normalcy by gathering together in our usual worship space. For all we know and believe that the ministry and mission of the church goes on, whether or not the building itself is the home base of operations, we long to meet in person and to work together again. For all we know and believe that committees and fellowship and worship can happen online, we want the exile from the building to end. For all we want to show the world and each other that we have faith in the face of fear. And make no mistake, there is a very real fear of this virus. It has the potential to cause long-term suffering and even death. It is not actually faith, but fear that causes the church to worry. That the longer we stay apart, the harder it will be to come together again. The church body is simply not gathered in the same way as it used to be. Its worship and work is not centralized in its building space any longer. In some ways, it can feel as if we are like dry bones scattered in a desert valley. And that's when God speaks to us, as God spoke to Ezekiel. We hear a voice asking, "Can these bones live? Can these bones live?" Ezekiel has a wise answer to this question. He says, "You know, O God." Only God knows the answer. Only God knows how the church will not only survive, but live. In Ezekiel's vision, God's answer was yes. Yes, they can live. God told Ezekiel to speak to the dried up old dead bones to tell them that they would live again. That God would put flesh and tendons and skin upon them once more. Ezekiel obeyed God and spoke to the bones. As he was speaking, he heard the sound of rattling, the bones coming together, the toe bone connected to the foot bone connected to the heel bone connected to the ankle bone. God not only connected the bones, but God recreated the bodies. And then God brought the breath of the Spirit from the four corners of the earth and breathed life into the bodies. They lived by the power and grace of a life-giving God. This is the same God in whom we believe today, as we professed earlier in our confession of faith. In life and in death, we belong to God. We trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. We trust in God the Holy Spirit, everywhere, the giver and renewer of life. We trust. In the end, it comes down to one thing. Trust. Do you trust God? Do you believe in the resurrection? That's the crux of our Christian faith, isn't it? Jesus went to the cross, trusting in God's power to bring life from death. Perhaps what we have known as church is dead. Only God knows. In many ways, it has been dying for a while. We've tried to reconnect the bones, to put flesh and sinew on them with our programs and missions. We've tried to breathe new life into the way we worship with changes in music and technology. Even before the pandemic, we have been asking for years, will the church live? Only God knows. But we know a few things, too. We know that Jesus' resurrection proves that God is able to bring life from death. We know that Jesus has promised never to leave us or forsake us, that he is with us to the end of the age. We know from Scripture, from words spoken by prophets and apostles, that God loves us. And that nothing can separate us from the love of God. We know that Christ is the cornerstone of the church, and that God has work for us to do. And we know that when God gave Ezekiel the vision of the valley of dry bones, And God asked him, "Can these bones live?" Ezekiel answered, "You know, O Lord." God replied with a vision and a promise to share with the people. "I will bring you back to Israel, and when that happens, you will realize that I am the Lord. My spirit will give you breath, and you will live again. I will bring you home, and you will know that I have kept my promise. I, the Lord, have spoken." Do you trust God to bring you home? Do you trust God to bring new life from death? Yes, the church is changing while we are in exile. For some, the thought of change causes fear. For others, the thought of change brings hope. There is fear that things will not be the same. There is hope that things might be better. The church has been in need of a fresh wind from the Spirit, blowing the breath of life into it from the four corners of the earth. These bones of the church that are socially distanced from each other in a desert, as if scattered in a valley, separated from the fellowship and worship that we are used to. Will this time apart cause the church to die? Can these bones live? Only God knows. Only God knows how our homeland will be changed because of the pandemic we are living in. Only God knows what the church will be like when we return to our buildings. Only God knows how the church will be changed. But one thing is sure. In Jesus Christ, God has given us hope in the promise of resurrection. And no matter what changes await the church, no matter what the future holds or what may happen, in life and in death, we belong to God. Trust in God, for God will bring us home.
Lord, our fellowship, Lord, our joy divine.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Creator, and the peace, the presence, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.